Hello, everyone, and welcome back to AI Quick Bits, snackable artificial intelligence content for everyone. My name is Scott, and today I'm going to be speaking with Lori Mazor. Lori is the CEO and founder of Synthetivity, a company that develops AI and metaverse applications, as well as providing design, consulting, and workshop services in the space. Lori's projects range from physical buildings to technology products and services. She regularly guest lectures on design, strategy, and operations. She is a multimedia artist whose creative work has been published in the New York Times, Inside Higher Education, Crane's New York Business, and the Wall Street Journal. Lori is a recipient of the American Institute of Architects Award for Design Excellence, and Crane's New York Business named her one of its 40 Under 40 Rising Stars. Lori, thank you so much for speaking with me today. How's it going?
It's going really well. How are you doing?
I'm great. I have several things I'd like to discuss with you today, but I would like to start with a recent newsletter post you wrote in your newsletter, Humans of AI, about chatbot personas. And I believe in the post you experimented with ChatGPT speaking with you as a benevolent cheerleader, a tough love coach, a difficult parent, even the bully. And if you're, would you talk to me about why you wanted to experiment with different tones from ChatGPT?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think my premise is that I am a teacher first and foremost. And, you know, I am trying to teach people from a place of learning myself and sharing in real time the things that I'm doing and the explorations I'm doing out of curiosity and what lessons I'm learning. And I think, you know, some of the lessons are the amazing creativity that the generative AI applications enable. And some of them are the scary aspects of it and things that we might want to think about and be more cautious of as we think about rolling out these applications in our businesses and in our schools and in our personal lives.
I totally agree, especially something like a bullying tone when it was obviously, you know, well, I believe OpenAI is pretty good about putting disclaimers or guardrails. So when you in your post with the bully persona, it did say like, hey, you know, this isn't really something I do, but it was pretty easy for you to say, but if it, you know, give me an example of something that we shouldn't do or something like that. And it did give you a bit of a tone of a bully. And I think I enjoyed your conclusion about needing an ethics framework for personas and the transparency into the establishment of like the base persona when someone starts to just use the product, like the setup, like, hey, give the user power to craft their chatbot to kind of their preferred style. I thought those were good suggestions.
Yeah. And I think, you know, one of the things that I learned over the process of teaching is, you know, I incorporated the original GPT-3 model into a teaching and learning application for high school students. And when I did that, I had a developer basically kind of write a program that scripted the bot in terms of what the bot would be able to do functionally, how it would engage with students, what tone of voice. And then literally he gave it a personality. And so I think I had that experience before ChatGPT really became popular. And so I can kind of see under the hood. And I know that when I am communicating with a machine, that that machine is basically a statistical machine, right? I mean, we are talking about a technology that is about predictive language. So all it's doing is looking at how we've used language historically and then predicting what the most likely word is to come next after a word or a phrase that you've put in. And so, you know, I think that's really, it's really important to recognize what it is and what it's not. And that, you know, humans have then given the bot a personality, a style of engaging with you. And the benevolent cheerleader is actually the natural style of GPT 4, mm-hmm. 3.5 and 4, which is, you know, the ChatGPT that you get when you sign up either for free or paid subscription. But, you know, one of the most powerful ways to use it is actually to tell it first who you want it to be in order to speak in that voice. And so, you know, I experimented with a bunch of good bots, and then I also tried experimenting with some not so nice personalities. What was really interesting was I put a poll up on LinkedIn the day after I did the newsletter, asking people, you know, what kind of voice, what kind of coach motivates you to do your best work? And no one picked the bully.
of course.
And actually, I kind of phrased it as like the disgruntled customer, because, you know, I think we all receive negative feedback either from our customers or our colleagues or sometimes our bosses. And, you know, one of the ways that you could then use the chatbot in a positive way is to like take that negative feedback and say, you know what, can you reframe this for me in a positive way that would motivate me? Right. And so, you know, I think a lot of the way that I use this is kind of as another voice in my own head. And sometimes it's good to, you know, write and to speak aloud the things that we want to hear that are going to inspire us or motivate us to do good things.
Yeah, I think it's interesting that there's so much, even though it is a sequential model with predictive text and whatnot, it's so good that if there's enough out there about someone, people are experimenting with, like, you know, pretend you're, you know, Steve Jobs or something like that, and speak to me in that type of mentorship type way. And of course, it's going to be based on past, not what, you know, a current Steve Jobs would say. But I think it's pretty remarkable how real it feels, or how alive it does feel versus, you know, if you were to say, I don't know, Shakespeare or Socrates or something, maybe it has a little less to draw on. But I would also just say that humans, even without conversation, will anthropomorphize. I mean, a lot of people, their car, you know, they kind of feel like it's even like a, like an alive thing. They give it a name, that sort of thing. So we're way past, I mean, I think it's a given that people will feel like these machines are alive. Many people, even if they do know that they're not, there's sort of that, like that just natural human tendency. And I do feel like, because of that, you're right on to point out the need for an ethics framework.
Yeah. Well. And, you know, I have a 15-year-old daughter. And so I knew that Snapchat was an application that she uses with her friends. And I knew they had just come out with an AI component. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think there's a lot of people who are concerned. And so I had that conversation with her. I'm like, are you using this? She's like, no, not yet, but I just saw it. And I'm like, all right, you need to give me feedback. Let's do a controlled experiment here. I want to see how you and your friends are gravitating towards this. And we're going to have a conversation about it. And then we'll make a decision whether this is something that's good or bad. So, you know, we never say, like, you know, absolute no's in our house. It's more like, all right, let's experiment. Let's see. Let's be, like, intelligent about it. But I also was really surprised in teaching my first class to high school students. And you know, they are so savvy. And I think in many ways, they've grown up in a world where they know that they can't trust anything that's on the internet. And so they've already established really good habits about, you know, double and triple checking references and, you know, kind of living in this post-truth world that we're in. And I think, you know, one which then AI really exacerbates, both on the image side with the ability for anybody to develop a deep fake, to, you know, the chat side where you do anthropomorphize the machine. But I'm hopeful about the next generation. And, you know, I think they've got a good lens to look at this with, and they're a little bit more skeptical than I think those of us who've kind of grown up thinking that we can trust the world.
Yeah, it's funny you mention that. I have a teenage son as well, and a soon-to-be teenage daughter. And for a while there, I was, you know, when I was introducing them to devices when they were younger, like, okay, here's your computer. Here, you know, you have a phone for the first time, and you're sort of worried, like, that they're going to get phished or click on something for some spam. And now I'm kind of like, oh man, my son, he knows, like, that's spam. Don't touch that. Yeah. Like, he's very sort of like, oh, you know what? I don't have to worry. Like, you're right. Their lens is completely different. They can sniff out that sort of stuff. Okay, I'd like to move on a little bit here. You have something that you do called Midjourney Mondays, where you, I believe, you know, basically, is it sort of like a weekly blog where you create with Midjourney? You have images created, and so I actually, one of your recent posts, I thought was just stunning. These dancing images that sort of look if I went to a dance performance at a performing arts center, the costumes are wild. They're just really, really interesting images. As much as you're comfortable with, could you take me through or talk to me about the creative process you use with Midjourney?
This to me has really been magic. And, you know, I was a corporate executive. I was running operations for the City University of New York throughout the pandemic, dealing with serious issues and managing a large staff. And when I left that job, I decided to take a break and take a sabbatical. And it just happened to coincide with Midjourney being launched. And, you know, I was trained as an architect. I had been in the performing arts. I'd been a dancer my whole life until I was in my mid-20s. And so, you know, I hadn't done anything creative like that in so long that it was amazing to me that I could use language, which is a skill that I have been perfecting over the years in terms of communicating with clients and customers. And, you know, those skills now could conjure up a physical image, right? And I wasn't limited to being an architect and designing buildings. I could design fashion and I could design, you know, I could do choreography. And so for me, it's just given me this playground that I can explore ideas that I'm really interested in. And, you know, I can literally do it sitting in front of the television with my family and, you know, just like writing prompts and seeing them come up on the screen. So, you know, I think the dancing images were probably like 13 or 14 weeks into my process. And, you know, I started with the idea of folded paper buildings, and I just kept like pushing that to the point at which it started to become clothing. And then Midjourney also kept evolving, and so it got better and better at generating realistic looking people. So I could start putting my clothing on bodies. Then I started realizing that, you know, the bodies that came out of the box were all white and all thin. I really wanted more diversity. And I started to recognize the problems with the models, the way that they'd been trained, and a bit of disillusionment. So, you know, I kind of went through the typical Gartner hype cycle with Midjourney, which is like, it's amazing, and then it's so terrible. But I think through that process, kind of figured out ways of creating my own code of ethics for how I engage with the application.
Yeah, that was going to be my next thing I was going to ask you about. Keep going, please.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of bad stuff that has already happened, right, in terms of workers who were exploited in order to, you know, be digital factory workers around the globe, in terms of artists whose work was used without their permission. And, you know, I want action to happen on those things, and I try and be an active part of the community that's changing how that happens. But I also think that in the meantime, I want to kind of establish my own rules for what I think is a ethical way for me to engage with the technology. And, you know, something that aligns with my values, which is, you know, I want to do things that are accessible to everyone. I believe the world needs to look like the world really looks. And, you know, I really want to try and override systems so that I'm an active participant in training the model to see and register a wider variety of human beings.
That's awesome. If you don't mind, I actually would like, because you do have a Midjourney Mondays manifesto, and yeah. I would love to actually go through some of these bullets that you came up with. And you have like, I shall not, and I'm going to go through these and we can talk about some of them in a little more detail, but I shall not use an artist's name in a prompt to replicate their style and present it as my own work. That's a very common sense, awesome one. And of course, the artist community is, there's a chatter every day about intellectual property and copyright. And, you know, I think that's a great one to take. Use words of which I do not understand the meaning or cultural history to generate images that look cool. I think that's also very timely right now. I can speak to that. It's what's interesting. Have you used the Midjourney describe feature?
Oh yeah, absolutely. So describe is like, yeah.
It can be problematic. You know, like I took one of your dance images and put it into the describe feature of Midjourney, and you know, sometimes it's sort of, it will, you know, it's interesting what it may find that art style, it does come up actually with some artist names throughout some African-American and Japanese artist names, as far as like I guess it saw some similarities into those styles. But I've actually seen, you know, some questionable or downright problematic, you know, things come back from images like, oh, it happens to have a black person in here, but it's a lifestyle sports, outdoor sports sort of photograph maybe. And it'll say something, you know, like, African wildlife influence or something like that. And it's like, it doesn't say that if it's the white person I think that this is really important things to talk about here. Let me see go ahead.
Yeah, please. Let's just pause on that for a minute, because I think this is the big realization that I had and that I think a lot of my colleagues have had. And, you know, we now have evidence of implicit bias, right? If anybody had a question and, you know, didn't believe that it existed, I can show it to you.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
And it's now coded, right, in the system. And one of the, you know, one of the things that I think a lot of ethicists talk about is the fact that, you know, we've now frozen in time our history, and that history is sorted. So, you know, everything, and I'll use my example of white women. So, you know, one of the first studies that I did, I just typed in, I wanted to see an elderly woman wearing some of the clothing designs that I had. And so I typed in, you know, elderly woman, and then I put in my designs, and they all came back white. And I didn't write white. But, you know, if you look at the way that we use language, if you look at the way that we classify ourselves in racial and ethnic categories, white is the default. And it's very rare that anybody would call themselves out as being white, right? We definitely ask people who are not white to give themselves a label, but we don't do that often for white people. And so I think like what you're seeing in Midjourney is you're seeing a mirror on history. You're seeing a reflection of where we are as a society. And I think that's the first step in change. So I, you know, my intention is to use these, and you know, when I talk with students, you know, all ages, 17 to 71, it's like, okay, look at what is happening. This is the way the world is. If you want to change it, you have to actively counterbalance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I think you're right. I mean, basically, the predominant digital imagery or imagery that's scanned or whatever, even from the invention of photography and video, like basically people pointed their cameras at white people mostly. So that's obviously reflective in the data, which is, I had a very similar experience. And I would say, I think many people have with Midjourney. I was getting some really cool images back. This is during version 4. So the faces and fingers and stuff were a little stranger, but I was still really enjoying the imagery. It was like black and white imagery of people eating food on an Italian beach, and they were really cool, but they were all white people. And I had to specify black people or Asian people, et cetera, if I wanted any type of diversity in the images. And if I just wanted white people, then you just don't specify. And that is it was the default Midjourney. Same experience. Okay. Wow. I mean, I think everyone would be wise to read your Midjourney Mondays manifesto. There are other bullet points. I think everyone should think about how they are using these tools, and you know, it's a little you don't think about it. You do something cool, like, you know, maybe use like recently in the news or an artist's voice that someone uses for a song that's not really that artist, but, you know, and I posted on LinkedIn, like, that's kind of a cheat code to go viral, you know, like you're using someone else's name or likeness without their permission. You have a bullet that says, I shall not generate photorealistic images intended to represent current events that did not happen. I think that's also a huge bucket. I mean, misinformation, yeah. Deep fakes. Also, I like that you put, you know, basically imagery in general, human imagery has from the beginning of it has perpetuated objectification and violence against women. So I shall not present hypersexualized images of women who are not controlling the gaze. I think that's also very important. So these are, I think everyone could maybe even it would behoove them to make their own, manifesto of how they would use generative AI tools. Great. I would like to also get into, like, you through your company, Synthetivity, you do workshops and boot camps. What specific generative AI tools do you teach? You know, I assume ChatGPT and Midjourney, but are there others?
Yeah, I mean, I start with free tools because that's accessible to everybody. And so I teach ChatGPT and DALL-E. And, you know, what I'm really teaching is communication skills. I'm teaching people how communicating with a machine is different than communicating with a human. I'm teaching them, you know, a lot of people will call it prompt engineering, but I actually call it prompt poetry because it's more like the social sciences and the humanities than it is engineering. And my father's an engineer, so I think I definitely think he prefers numbers.
I certainly think engineers are kind of like prompt engineering. What are you talking about there?
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
And I teach people about the art of losing control. And this, to me, is one of the toughest lessons to teach to corporate executives, particularly women. And I think it's because, you know, I ask everybody in the room before the class starts, I'm like, who likes to be in control? And, you know, everybody raises their hand. I don't think there's a person who is in corporate America, who's in a leadership position, who doesn't want to control the outcome of their actions. But the thing about generative applications is that they're all about statistics, probability, and chaos. And you can't control the outcome. And you know, there's a certain metric that's called temperature, which is kind of how narrow the field of statistics you get when you're asking for an image to be generated or words to be generated. And you can set that band narrowly or you can set it widely. And, you know, that creates, you know, way more variety if you have a high temperature setting. But, you know, I think what we all are learning with this is something that I learned actually as being a client, being on the client side of architecture, which is that, you know, half of the work is in what you communicate as your intention. And then you really like turn things over either to a third party who might be doing work for you or, you know, to somebody on your team who might be taking things. And you then get something back. And at that point, your role is to curate. You can comment, you can give feedback. And, you know, you go back and forth and you have a conversation. And, you know, I think this is an art that everybody in business should learn. Because I think if we are so focused on controlling outcomes, we really miss opportunities that come to us serendipitously. And, you know, I think creativity is going to be the superpower of this era.
Yeah, and I think you're right on with prompt engineering being not the correct word, or maybe being something like prompt poetry. Or to me, there's a direct line between the conversational style of these large language models and then the input that we would do to create imagery with these machines. I mean, it seems like why would people learn nuanced differences and different ways to prompt all the products that are coming. It's going to move to natural conversation of what you want to see as an image or whatever. So why wouldn't it be? I get there's a short term. I'm sure plenty of people are having a lot of success with their, you know, paragraph long prompts with weighted, you know, colons and numbers and everything. And they get very specific and it can happen. You can do it that way. But I just don't see that being the way in 3 to 6 months that's how people are going to be successfully prompting these tools. It's going to naturally get to where it's communication, like you said, and it's going to be natural communication because that's how that's the UI that is basically being rolled out and developed right now is essentially chat and voice. This has been a very insightful and wonderful conversation. I really appreciate you coming on the show. I want to let people know that there is a code for 10% off of workshops at Lori's company. So it's just QuickBits10. I believe the website is Synthetivity.net. Is that correct, Lori?
You got it.
Okay. Synthetivity.net. QuickBits10 will get you a discount on some workshops there on Lori's website. And I can't tell you how much I appreciate you coming on the show. I really appreciate it.
Oh, thank you. And thank you for such thoughtful and insightful questions. It was really great talking with you.
Okay. Have a good day.
You too.